Now, in the time we were making this video, Milk Graham had sent me a file, and when I downloaded it, of course it took quite a long time to download it, but boy was it worth it. I gotta share this. This is a project, not many people get to this level, but Milk Graham's been sending us some really exciting stuff. This is really world-class stuff. Let me share this with you. I have the file on my computer, and I can just, it'll take a few minutes, but let me show you some of the things I thought were pretty amazing. Again, these are from Milk Graham, and there's over 100 pictures. I'm just going to pick the ones that I think are really impressive. Here's the center section of the wing. This is from a Globemaster. Talk about an overwhelming modeling project. Just take a look at a few of these pictures. Unbelievable. That's a person standing back there by the rudder. Imagine the size of it. Imagine when I go to fly this thing. He's outwindied Windy here. Outwindied somebody. Unreal. A wingtip or something. Yeah, this reminds me of that. We had that the person that made, they died actually while they were making it, and the club finished making that eight-engine Hughes flying boat. This looked very similar. It looks even bigger, in fact. Anyway, if you'd like this whole complete set design, I think it's 132 pictures. I'm not going to hit them all, but Milt Graham downloaded each one of them, and he made a file. You probably could get a hold of Milt, and it's quite a show. It'd probably take too long to put on a video, but there's some really, really interesting stuff. Look at the size of this. You could shove this kid inside of it. Now, in something that's similar to this, and it's a shame we're never going to get to see it, down at the anodizing shop, one of the fellows that was working down there was making a C-130 with, not this big, of course, but a big giant fuselage, and they've sold the building, so we're not going to really ever see it unless we find out where he's headed, where he's going to store it. Well, where do you store something like? You need a garage to store this. Not only that, just imagine if this thing flies into something and hits it. Like a house. A battleship. Wow, this thing is unbelievable. I wonder how much balsa, well, maybe it's not even balsa wood. I'm going to try to get more information on this project. There apparently is a website where you can find the information. I haven't been able to find it yet, though, but this is a pretty impressive piece of equipment. This guy must have his own website. Speak about having his own. You want your own website? Hey! Get out of here. Trying to look at these pictures, he's bothering me. Yeah, that's right, son. You just climb up inside of this sucker. I wonder what they use for batteries on this. You know, they must have servos that, see, I don't really know. We watched those giant quarter scale mob, bigger than quarter scale, fly at the gnats. They have giant servos. And the guy apparently lives in Ireland. Can you imagine? I guess you need the country of Ireland to... Can't imagine where you would even fly this. Way out in the country. If this ever flew away, can you imagine? Some of the exotic flap mechanisms. This guy must be some craftsman. But boy, you just never know. In the world of modeling, there's just so many cool things. It's Globemaster, but this is 129 already. Anyway, Milt has a whole set. I really appreciate sharing this. I love to share this stuff. I even wonder what kind of motors he has in here. Now, this is something I'd buy a video of this flying or the guy building it. This guy could have made a fortune just videotaping how he built this thing. I don't know, that's quite a model. He's out sweeper the sweeper. Look at the landing gear, it's what, 18 main wheels? I first downloaded this picture, I thought, oh, it's control line and he has a special windy handle or a Ted Fancher handle or something. Nah, it's just the flap part. And it even has real strobe wingtip lights. You believe this? This is unbelievable. But that's what's unique in the world of modeling, is just how many things. You don't have to be a follower. You can be a leader. You can do things you want to do. Never be a follower. And taking it from, I'm assuming this is sheets of plywood, the parts they cut out. Just an unbelievable project. Maybe it's all laser cut. Who knows? Somebody nicked the kit. You can imagine they'd sell a lot of these kits. Simply unique in all the world. There's a lot to be said for being unique and big. You look at appearance rows, again, there's just something to be said for having something that's just a little bit different, a little bit unique, not the run-of-the-mill. Just build something that stands out in the crowd, something a little bit different than everybody else. There definitely is something to be said for that. And our friend with the Globe Master truly has accomplished that. There's no doubt in my mind. He's way ahead of me. Okay, two things we want to do. I want to get this sanded out, possibly get the next coat of silver on it. But while I'm waiting for some of that to dry up, I have the spare cowls. I put this, the original cowl, back together, but it's just too sloppy. Luckily, I've already had molded these ahead of time. In fact, I got one that's already trimmed off. And what I need to do is, and I'll do it off camera, is just make up this mount, make a mirror image of this mount, glue it into this side, and then while things are drying, I can be working on another cowl. And just imagine, if you didn't have a cowl mount, what would happen here? I mean, if you didn't have a cowl mold, you'd be carving up a 5.5-inch block of wood right now. But either way, that cowl mold has saved our life more than once. Now it turns out that it just was easier to use up a new cowl. We dumped the original one, copied the back plate mount, used it for a pattern. At least it worked out well as a pattern. I did a little test fit, made sure the bolts lined up, everything looks good. Now I'm going to start putting the finish on the cowl. And tomorrow when I come back down the shop, I'll start sanding this. This will dry overnight, and that should be really nice. It should, well, let's hope. Every time I think it's going to sand out, and I always want one more coat. Now today, our third coat of silver is dried up, and I'm looking for spots that I know are going to be a problem, and I know there are several. One of them is right here where I put my finger. So what I'm going to try to do is just basically sand that out, maybe put a little nitrous stain in there. I see a couple spots here that I'm not real happy with, even though this is going to all get faded in. You probably won't see that. But right here we have what, even on the original plane, was kind of an iffy area. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to try to harden this up by making a pin cushion out of it, putting some thin CA in there, and then sanding it back down. And you can see that that's not really a good area right there. And I've worked on that several times. I might have to live with that. Now, if we were at the point here, and I don't want to spray a whole nother coat of silver, I just want to do little touch-ups. If I were doing a brand new plane, and this was the original finish, I would be thinking, well, I'll sand this whole coat out again. But because I'm trying to minimize the amount of time I spend doing this, I don't want to put another 200 hours into the finish of this. I want to keep it to a minimum. So doing these little touch-ups like this, this will certainly be good enough. And considering that last week this plane was in about 300 pieces, I don't know. I'm not sure that I shouldn't just be quitting while I'm ahead. But anyway, and if it doesn't work, it's certainly going to be no worse than it was. So let me show how I do this once, and then you can just envision that I've done this at other spots on the plane. Now the idea is to see if you have an area where it's not really sticking down well, and this looks like it's actually sticking pretty well. But what I'm doing, I'm putting
a brand new number 11 blade, just putting a million little holes in it. Turn it into a pin cushion. And this again is one of the things. Sometimes this works real well, sometimes it doesn't work well at all, depending on what the issue is. Now we have thin spots in this wood. Right here it's thin, I can see that. See, that's gonna be an issue. That what's happening that is you've got a skin that's delaminating off the wood here. And this'll make it better. I don't think it'll make it perfect. But you just spend 5-10 minutes and you can feel where it's rock hard, and then right up here it's soft as can be. But well, you gotta get all the pinholes in on the first shot. Now what's good about this, it adds almost no weight. If you put nitrous stain on top of this, of course, it's okay too, but you're adding weight. This way you're just putting up like a thousand little thumbtacks to hold those finishes down, the little finish that wants to come up off. And again, if it doesn't work the way that you're happy with, and I can see there's a hard spot, that's where the glue joint is there. See the little bubble in the fillet here, we could take care of that while we're doing this. And it looks like this is one of the best tricks I know of, and like I said, there's many times when you sand in coats of silver on a new finish and you see what looks like the finish not adhering, this can save your day, as opposed to stripping it all off. You just never have too many of these little pinholes. And what that does, it helps harden up the wood underneath it and let these little, what amount to be areas that aren't sticking to the substrate. And then if this isn't quite level, we can put on. Let's just do one little area at a time. And you want to press down, and you can feel it start to go off. And we got this area up here to do. And believe me, this stuff is capillary. It goes right into those holes. And once you get proficient at doing this, you can really cover up a lot of your errors, mistakes. Now, you don't want to use kicker, of course. You want to let this just sit for a few minutes. We'll let this sit, and then we'll sand it down and see what we have. Now, when we sand this with 600, all of those little imperfections are going to come right to the top. Now, the other trick, when you're spraying over this, we want to spray dry. We don't want to have any, as little thinner in the paint as possible. We don't want to go down and soften everything up underneath, if possible. Again, there's several areas here I'm going to do. I'm just going to do one on camera, just give you some little idea. I already put some nitrous stain down there. Now you can see I'm back down to where there's raw wood. The best thing is just use your finger. Bare finger finds these spots. And when you do spray it dry. Now, it doesn't feel perfect, but it sure feels better than it did. And we can also put another coat right on here, which will help harden up that wood and keep that wood from popping up. You can just do this endlessly until you get it to lay down the way you want. Or you can cover it with nitrous stain and just live with the fact it adds a little extra weight. And never use kicker on it. Let it just work it in like that. As soon as that dries, again, we don't want to spend too much time, and especially before I test fly this and make sure that we don't have damage somewhere else in the plane that the bell crank is going to pull out or something. That was another little area there. But that's basically how I pick away at it. Now, I don't need to recoat the whole silver. I just can do that one little area. And now where that fillet is, what I can do, where's my little tool? Like I said, try finding the tool in the shop. I think the bird took my tool. I get my little edge tool, or fold sandpaper over and get that little fillet in there. Again, my original intent was going to be I wasn't even going to put a final finish on this. I was just going to spray it silver, but what's changed my mind is we're waiting for these two hurricanes to pass by, and they said 5 days terrible weather. Well, I may as well use it. And then this, no matter what happens, if in the worst of all world, I can give this wing to Mike Estella when I make the new wing. Or I can make the wing with no dihedral. I've got a lot of choices. Okay, that looks like it's feathered in pretty well. Now I'm going to do the rest of the areas pretty much the same way, and then we'll see what we have. Example of something where we're not getting a good bind here. You can see it's a soft spot. Give it the old pincushion trick. Look at this helper. The pincushion. Why can't I teach you how to do this? Give it a second. That usually, 99 times out of 100, will take care of it. And once that dries, we're going to sand out any spots that are bad. And you can see how many we've got here. I've just been picking away at it, and then I'll get another coat of silver on this. Where I'm spraying, what I want to do is get the areas that I've repaired with relatively dry material. An example would be 50-50 thinner. Then when I have those areas coated, I'll put one wet coat on the whole thing. I'll just add some thinner to the mix, so it'll be like maybe 60-40 then. But I want to get a real dry coat over this, because the dry coat will cover and it won't penetrate down in, the same as you don't want to get wet lacquer or dope over Letra sets. Just pretend the whole plane is a Letra set now. Now, just in case you didn't know, and I know you don't care, tomorrow is my birthday. I'm going to be 59 years old. Bob Zambelli's supposed to stop up with his Argus, which, ironically enough, he's had to do a little repair on. So we're going to cry on each other's shoulders, cry the blues. I'm telling you, I hate the crashing plane. But it looks like maybe a week or now, 10 days from now, we're going to have ourselves a heck of a good test plane. I doubt we'll ever compete with this again, but we sure won't take full advantage of it. And we will use everything that we learned from this project. Every single thing that's from this is going to go into our Tigercat project. But I guess normally, or even if you don't want to, every plane you build becomes a building block for the next one. Things you learn, things you improvise. Looks like the repairs that we've done have turned out pretty well. The only thing you can run a problem if you make the paint too dry, that you don't get adhesion, or that you get that sandpaper, and I see I'm getting some up by the fuselage where it's like overspray. So when you want to avoid overspray, you shoot from the nacelle or fuselage out. Don't shoot up against it. And I see the storm is coming. They're predicting another 5 days of this stuff. I mean, when I wake up in the morning, it isn't a decision as to whether you're going to fly or not. It's a decision as to whether you got to batten down the hatches. And we were planning on having a nice outdoor birthday party. Forget it. We're going to plan on having an indoor party. All right, we pretty well have this covered. Going to let this dry up.
Idea, at least so far, where our repair areas were here and on the other side, they look like they're going to work out okay. But even if they didn't, the philosophy is not a big deal. Just do it again. You're not adding any weight, and you're just taking time. But is to get all these loose areas to stick down, and even on new finishing, you can wind up having areas like that. So it's a good idea to know real quickly how to deal with them. I think we're going to have to deal with something before, but the sky is closing in on us here. Not looking like we're going to be painting an hour from now. But we did get a coat of silver on. We're going to let this dry overnight. Tomorrow we have the cowling to work on. And then we'll start doing the red and the black leading edge. Okay, a little bit of time here, and one of the next steps I wanted to do, I made myself a little list of what I want to do in what sequence. The mast off the wingtips, they have to be painted red. I have to do a lot of work on the cowl. You can see there's a lot of little spots on the cowl. I was hoping I could get the cowl painted the red too, but it needs a little more prep. We always tissue over the carbon just to give the finish a nice base. And that's always what I do with carbon fiber parts, is use tissue. But the next step, and if I can get this done tonight, this will really be one step ahead. Get the wingtip painted, then the last of the paint will be the black leading edge de-icer boot. And then once that's all pulled off, and by then we'll probably be in the middle of having our giant birthday party that's happening tomorrow, then we'll have to do all the ink line and shading, and there's quite a bit of work left, including cutting the holes for the cowls. But if I can get this done, this certainly would be a get me one step ahead. And anytime I can get a little bit ahead, I'm always happy. And because it's raining out there, you can see the humidity. I've had to spray this in the cellar. Look at the humidity. So what I may have to do is just wait. Oh, it's not looking real good. Wait, and then put a little bit of retarder in the red and spray another coat on. In the meantime, I did the tip weight box, and you can see that fogged up, but don't have a lot of choice about it right now. And I want to start wet sanding out the cowl while I'm waiting for that to dry. So just trying to make the most use of the time that we have. Now you can see, even though it's drizzling and raining out here, we're still able to get some painting done. We put about a spoonful, a little more than a spoonful of retarder in the red, and it looks like it's drying up well on the second coat. And it's drying up real nice. It just takes about a spoonful of retarder in the paint, and you really never want to put in more than you really need. As long as it's not fogging up, that's going to dry up fine. Remember, we're trying to avoid putting a lot of retarder in the paint for the simple reason that we don't want everything going down into the substrate here and getting it mushy. Now what we're going to do is just do a lot of sanding on this cowl, and probably, hopefully fix spots like this with some nitrous stain, and everything else just gives a couple more little spots. Just keep sanding and putting a silver on. We could put as much as we want on, because on a carbon fiber part, what's nice, you're not going to scratch it or anything, you just grind away at it. Now while I'm painted drying, I made myself some snow cones. Look who's eating snow cones. Hey, those are my snow cones, you know. He's gonna knock it over. You gotta knock it over, dumb bird. Birds don't eat snow cones. Look at this, he's eating snow cones. Snow cones! I can't even work on my computer here. He's eating snow cones. Hard to believe. If you didn't see this with your own eyes, you wouldn't believe it. Anyway, all our paint is drying. Looks like tomorrow we'll be able to paint on the black leading edge. And, boy, I'm just as happy as can be about the way this repair is coming out. Now, it looks like today we're going to need one more coat on the cowl. One more, see, you can see the little spots. See it right there? Still some little spots that one more sand out with, probably with 1200 will take care of that. Here's a couple little spots there. That's why you do this with silver. And I'm doing it with B25 silver just because I'm trying to skip some steps here, but no reason to do it. You could use regular silver. I just happen to have that in a gun. See, there's a little spot up there with a tissue overlap. But one more sand out will take care of that. Hopefully that'll take care of the cowling, and then we'll be ready to put the red ring on it. The red dried up beautifully yesterday, so we're ready to go on red. And the next step on here, even though this is my birthday day, I got up real early this morning, and what I wanted to do, I want to back mask off the black leading edge so that can be drying. And then hopefully the next time after the black leading edge is done, the next step is going to be the ink work, which is a pretty labor intensive thing. And also, then I'm going to have to bolt the motor in at some point in time, cut all the holes for the cowl, and then hopefully dedicate, I'm sure it's going to be longer than you think it is, at least one day to inking. I'll have to take all the tinfoil off, inking everything up. I'm trying to lay out all these steps in my mind, because what happens, I've been working on this so many hours in the last week or so that I'm just getting hypnotized by it. But I'm not unhappy for a second at the way it's coming out. I'm already dreaming about the day it's going to be at the field, and we're going to get some more flights out of it. And all these late nights and early mornings and everything, they're all going to pay off with one stroke of the pen the day this gets back in the air. And hopefully there'll be no other damage in it, and we'll get many more years of good service, and a lot of other people will enjoy flying it. Now in this case, all I have to do is back mask this black leading edge, spray that, and while that's drying, see, I always try to do, while something's drying, I can sand out the cowl and do the next step on the cowl. So that always works out well for me, to try to get the first thing of the day, get something in masked off and drying, because that'll take an hour or two, maybe longer. But in the meantime then, being able to get two things done at the same time, while Karen's up there prepping for the birthday party today, and we're hoping we're going to have a nice party. Even though there are as if we didn't have enough bad weather, there's a hurricane, the edge of a hurricane coming our way. Now, because it's still drizzling a little bit out there, I decided to try to do this with an airbrush. Saved me from having to deal with the humidity out there. So once we get that cowl done, and I'll do the sand out on that again, just a question of sanding it out over and over again until all those little flaws go away. I gotta tell you, it stinks knowing you're 59 years old as of this morning. Wow. When I was younger, I never thought I'd reach 40. It was like Billy Martin. If I knew I was gonna live this long, I would have saved more money or something. And as we come down a home stretch on this little repair, probably realistically this is 100 hours you see condensed into 2 hours of video.
had really worked on this early in the morning and late at night and all through the day and tried to deal with the rain. Now, doing the ink, which is going to be one of the next steps, is going to be a little more involved than I thought it would be because I'm going to have to do a good match. But I guess when you do the original plane, you're doing a real match too, so I guess I haven't won or lost anything yet. It's just that I have a pattern I can work from now. But I hope I didn't throw away any of those inking templates that I made. I think I gave them all to Mike Costello, though. I'll have to get them back. And thanks to Ed Cotton, who showed me how to make all those curved templates. If we have to, we can even make them over again. Okay, it's finally time to take off the tinfoil and see what we have. This is my favorite part of any paint job.
Joy taking its tape off. The old garbage can full of actually it's a whole roll of masking tape and a whole thing of tinfoil in one shot. Interesting to see if we still have some repairs to do on the flap here, but I'm not real interested about that right now. I want to see if this is going to come out and if I've been able to save this. Because this is quite a few hours of masking and back masking, so if I've been able to save that, that's a big factor. Looks like we've been able to salvage this little bit of trim. Now the next thing I'm going to do is take the whole plane, because I've got fingerprints and things on it, and totally clean the whole plane with M600. And because we're going to be putting clear on top of
ball of this as I'm going every step. I want to get all the tape residue, fingerprints. It'll help with the inking too when we get time to do that. I'm not going to get to do that today, of course. This big birthday party coming up. Anyway, you see I still have some damage here, but what I've decided to do is little spots like this I'm going to do kind of on an ongoing basis. Whenever I have some free time, I'll just come in and work that area. Since that's on the bottom, I'm not real nervous about it, that's for sure. And these tape edges I'm going to have to break down with a credit card. There's, just like a new paint job, there's tape edges. This also gets some of the dust overspray off. Actually, it's better than I thought it would be. Now, knocking these edges down will be important. In fact, where these tape edges end, every time, well, we're going to put clear on it, I'm just going to move it just slightly. So I try to minimize the amount of edge that I have. Now once I'm done with this, I'll re-clean everything with M600 so it's as clean as it possibly can be before we start the ink work. Now one of the things that turned out to be a lot more work than I thought it would be was getting this inner flap hinged in because these pieces had broken out. I thought this was just going to be a 5-minute job snapping it back in. We wound up taking a couple hours getting the little pieces of wood put back in and getting everything lined back up because I had taken all the alignments, of course, and I wanted to make sure I didn't get these in crooked. Even though I have adjusters, I want to go, like to go back to exactly where I was when we had this accident. So the next step is I'm going to, as long as I'm doing flaps, I'm going to sand the whole bottom of this out, try to fill in all these little dents, and I hope, well, I hope that's going to be ready for the inking then the next time we have a session. But this is, a lot of days there's one little thing, and I always say this, there'll be a big giant part that just goes as very quickly. And then there's one little thing like this that'll just eat up the better part of a day. It's always these little things, as Gilda Radner used to say, it's always something. Amazing. So here it is, Wendy's 59th birthday. The lovable 59-year-old is getting hamburgers for his birthday.
That's right.
And he predicted rain, thunder, lightning, but boy, it's hanging tough today, kids.
Yeah, tough.
Not a drop of rain so far. Oh, you lucky dog.
Yeah, no rain.
You lucky dog. 59 years old. Who'da thunk it? Who'da thunk it?
59.
Twin engine planes and 59 years old. Well, my whole family's here to wish me a 59th birthday and hope you enjoy sharing a minute or two with us. God, when I was younger, I never thought I'd see 59. Unbelievable. There are a lot of treats going on here. We got a birthday. I haven't eaten ice cream since I went on a diet on January 12th. I lost 30 pounds, but I'm not going to lose any weight today. Forget it.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. That's my pet piranha. Happy birthday to you.
The truth is we did get a couple of drops of rain, but not enough to cancel our party. And as Karen always does, she threw a wonderful, wonderful party. How are those burgers coming here, Grillmeister?
Going all right.
Oh my God, look at this. The Grillmeister's going.
Yeah, hey, we got rolls.
Hey, don't burn my rolls, boy.
Baby, don't worry.
And here we have the ambitious part of the future of the franchise over here. Yeah. Well, so far we have beat the rain. 59, it's just hard to believe. Unbelievable to be 59.
I was so young when I met Karen. Now I'm 59.
Picture this company in Florida called General Development. Port St. Lucie, Port Panama, Port Orange, Port.
Is that an ice cream cake?
An ice cream cake.
No. Oh, hey, I'm not a day over 20. Look at this. Whoa. You guys are going to all sing happy birthday to me or what? Oh, man, look at this cake.
Wait, 1 second.
I feel like I'm in the Hall of Fame. Wait, I am in the Hall of Fame. What am I talking about? Happy birthday, Wendy.
Looks great.
Yeah, nice cake. This is the first time, second time I'm eating ice cream on my day. Oh, nice cream.
Wow, look at that.
This better not be the candles that never go out.
No, they're not.
You die blowing them out.
You have one of these.
Look at the smiley faces, look.
Yeah, those are great. They look like smiley faces.
Happy birthday to Wendy, the good looking guy. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday to Wendy. Happy birthday. Oh! Hey, blow out the gas.
Make a wish.
Well, you already made a wish.
How old is Wendy now?
59.
59. 59. Look at these presents. This is old man presents here.
This one's not for you.
Happy birthday, Wendy. Unbelievable. Go fix your A26. Unbelievable. Come on,
Hey. Make her show you.
Elizabeth, show everybody what you made for Wendy for his birthday. Let's see what it is. Let's see. Is that Chickadooly?
Look at that. How
cool. It's an extreme close.
Can I put that on my fence?
Yeah, but be very careful with the luck.
You're not eating anything with blue dye in it, are you? No snow cones.
Did you make that?
I'm going to put this in Chicky's cage. He probably won't go in the cage.
Because he doesn't like...
Look at what else. One of my other presents was the Soprano. The Life of the Soprano. Look, this looks...
Did you get this?
Look around. Does anything look the same here? Hey, it's Uncle Art and Uncle Wendy. Look at this. Hey, the Sopranos. Hey.
Hey,
bada bing. Hey, bada bing.
Why? Did you see
the
fence?
Yeah,
beautiful.
No, we've been fish. Stayed up with us tonight to enjoy Wendy's 59th birthday party. Whoopie-doo. No, I don't know. Back to working on that Tigercat tomorrow. Now today, what I'm going to try to do, get the pads and the engine in place, and cut all the holes for the cowl. I think we're ready to cut the holes for the cowl. Make sure that all the mounts line up. Anyway, that was a great birthday party. Thanks a lot to Karen and everybody that shared it with me. Need to cut that hole. Need to make sure I can choke the engine, the muffler, and the needle valve. Make sure all the bolts line up. And then we'll hopefully, before the day's over, be ready to paint the red on this, which will free us up for the next day to start the ink work. One of the things that was a little bit of a help here, I was able with a little open-end wrench to be able to bend this header right back into position, which I thought it was going to snap off and I'd have to have it re-welded. So that saved us one item. I got to get the pads back in place, take the muffler and the needle valve out, and we'll be pretty much ready to start cutting some holes for this. And this part of the job, because I've already done it once already, actually if this is the fourth time I'm doing it, something I shouldn't be so proud of. Gotta get the pads in there, make sure, and we've already used this to line everything up, so you would hope that it's gonna line up relatively well. I guess we're gonna find out right away. Now, because these mounts have been split, what I'm trying to do is get this bird out of here. I'm trying to get some JB Weld between the aluminum and the mounts, maybe reinforce it just a tad. Hey, get out of here. You're going to live in Texas, bird. Now, the idea of this is just to maybe stiffen this up just a little bit. We'll find out if this is going to be appropriate. I don't want to get any down by the bolt thread, so what I'll do is put a little bit of oil on the bolt threads so none of this winds up at the end of it. I can't take the engine out. A permanent engine. I don't think so. Actually, when I was a kid, I did make planes where the engine was built in and the cowling didn't come off and you couldn't get the engine out. Learned that lesson quickly in life. Okay, now these pads. Get out of here! Go on! Let's clean this out before I put the put a little bit of chain lube on the threads. Yeah, I really wouldn't worry about doing this if I didn't have the that where the mouth holes are, it was split. All right, now while that JB Weld is setting up, what that did, I hope, is reinforce this just a little bit. Now I can take my preliminary measurements for where the hole for the head of the motor is relative to the three cowl mounts. I can almost get it up on there and just get at least that the head can stick out of the cowl as this as step one.
I'm just doing a preliminary fit here to find out exactly where this is going to wind up. I'm going to center the hole here, but what we'll do is cut a little bit of the hole first. Just rough some of that out. Cut that out with a Dremel tool. Let the head stick up and then do the final fit. Usually I like to get the head centered first and then cut the other holes.
Now, it's always good if you can cut the carbon fiber with a carbide, one of the little carbide wheels that cuts very nice. And what I've done in the past is done all the painting and then cut the holes, but I think this is a better way to do it. This way we'll actually get the paint to seal up on the edges. Now, we just need to do a preliminary fit and then see where this hole has to be elongated and get enough that I can get in and choke the engine. Now you can see little by little by little I can just trace where I want a little more clearance and get this forward and step by step by step get a final fit on this hole with the cowl bolted in place. Then I have to cut the exhaust and the needle valve. Little by little I'm getting each cut. I want to match the fit to this similar to the other side, but of course I've got to work around that engine fit. Well, it takes a little bit of time. This is just a little bit labor intensive. Now with the top, this is good clearance. Now I measured over this way since I know the exhaust is right in the middle. A scratch. Now I'm going to measure off in this dimension from the front.
My heart is aching. I'm a fool. Let it go.
Let's see if I can get this relatively accurate the first shot. And we're right about roughly there. And that should give us a rough idea where we have to cut this opening for the exhaust. Now the next cut we have to make, we're going to do the same thing with the needle valve, line it up in this dimension, line it up in this dimension, and try to center the hole so we have a reasonably nice hole for the needle valve. This worked out well, and by the way, one of the things I never do is try to make a real tight fit around the exhaust here. What happens? The paint just blisters up. I like to keep plenty of clearance on that. All right, so the only thing left here is the needle valve hole, and this will be ready to paint the red trim on, which will be the next logical step here. Okay, you got the needle valve hole in. Next step, this worked out pretty well. Next step is just to back mask it. As soon as that's back masked, we'll be ready to paint the red. Okay, we got the cowl red painted, and that's probably all we're going to get to do today, but this will set us up for the next day, which I hope is going to be a really productive day. We're going to be able to get some or all of the ink work done. Well, as predicted, we're predicting a whole day of rain here, but it's not going to affect us at all, because today we're going to try to do the ink work. And hopefully by tomorrow, well, we'll be ready to start putting some clear on this. Let's hope. Coming down a home stretch on this, and I want to take a whole day, dedicate a whole day to doing the inking and the shading, if possible, even 2 days. Especially if this weather doesn't get any better. What we really have to worry about, and I guess I'll do the bottom first, make sure this is all perfectly clean with M600. Get out the pens, and you can see, decide what we're going to try to do is just match everything, measure, match, measure, match. What I thought would be the easiest way to do this is just to get all of the ink lines on first before doing the shading, just in case the weather gets a little better. But you can see we're not having a lot of luck. I also have to paint inside all inside cowl there. In fact, I think I'll take the motor out just to get it out of the way. And then I need to go over. I've already sanded the bottom of all these areas, and I need to go over the ink lines a second time because we're going to put more clear on top of this. And there's definitely some areas here that are going to need to be filled with clear. And the most difficult part, that's always a pain, is getting all these lines that connect from the wing over the nacelle. So we'll try to get some of this on video. We're dedicating a whole day or 2 days to it because this is one of the focal points. And you can see how hideous it looks without the ink work. And it's not like we're going to try to compete with this plane anymore. Basically going to be a test plane, but I know with the winter coming up, and if we get the counter-rotating props working the way we want, this will be a giant, giant step forward on the Tigercat project. So let me get out all the pens. This is one of the days, like, rainy day, may as well do the ink work. Good thing we're not ready to do the clear, or I'd be really frustrated, because you're not going to be able to spray clear. You can get away with doing the red and doing the little things, but painting the clear, I really want to get a sunny day, and they are predicting a sunny day Wednesday, so I really have 2 days to do this ink work. Just keep all my ink stuff, and here's all the different inks. All my templates. Hopefully I've saved all of them, or most of them, in fact, but I think I have. The ones I really am going to need, Mike Estella has, I'll have to recreate them. The ones that go between the wing and the fuselage, but even that's not a problem. Because when Ed Cotton was here, he left me some of the acetate to make the templates with. So if they're not in this wonderful box of junk, then I'll spread it out later and look at it. If I'm going to have to recreate some of those templates, and that one of them is the line that goes between here and here is a curved line on both, well, actually there's three sides. So what that'll mean is, we'll have to recreate the template, but because Ed Cotton was gracious enough to show us his method, and his method has worked really well, creating this curved ink line, we just make a template up for that, and it's very easy. Now, I've already given those to Mike Estella, and that's a real problem, because Mike's away on business right now. He's going to be out of town for a few days, so I can't even go over and get them. I don't even know where he has them in his shop. Anyway, just as easy to make another one anyway on a rainy day like this. The things we want to try on this, we're always looking to try new stuff. This is, it's called a safety ruler that Jerry Tarnowski gave us, Ultraflex. So you can bend this around things for doing ink lines. But obviously, one of the things you have to do is put tape on this side. So one of the things Jerry suggested doing, and I guess we're going to try this, is put the tape on, but don't put it all the way. Because what will happen when you go to bend this around, you may have a problem if I make that tape too, well, let's see. Otherwise, what we can do is take the tape and just make segments. Now, everybody that I've ever seen ink a plane, when it comes to doing some of these curved lines around a fuselage, they just go bonkers, and I'm the worst one. So I'm always looking for a way that'll make that easier. Now, when Jerry gave me this at Brodax, I was just dying for something to try it on. Not dying so much I wanted to crash a plane, but you can see what that would allow you to do. So I'm going to try this on some straight lines. Let's just see how it works. From Jerry Tarnowski, by the way. If you need to know where to buy one of these, and I don't know, Safety Flex Ruler 43011, but Jerry's in Pampa, and I'm sure he'd let you know where he got his, probably at an art supply store. Now, it's pretty obvious to me that on straight lines like this, it won't be a big deal at all. And I'm just using this as opposed to one of my normal rules just to get a feel for it. Hey, can't you be more help? You want to go live in Paducah, Kentucky? You're going. You're going to Tigercat Heaven down at Charlie Reeves' house. Look at this. He's such a big help. And talk to your relatives about not flying into the plane. Your ex-relatives. Buried on Boot Hill. Anyway, we had a wonderful birthday party. Hope you didn't mind sharing that few minutes with us. I think it's the magic of video that we can share each other's lives in a real fun way. Share the things we all seem to love, like inking planes. Now, these lines are already on the plane, but I've got overspray and sanding, and I just want to redo them because I'm going to redo the ink. But when it comes to the parts that I have to match, basically I'll take all the measurements off of the wing that is not destroyed. And I think I'll only have to make that one template up. It's looking like I'm only going to have to make that one. And boy, thanks to Ed Cotton, we know how to do that right now in a very efficient way. In the past, using 64th plywood, it was a lot more difficult. Yeah, this ruler looks like it's going to be fine. I can't wait to get up on I'll get most of the flat wing panel done and then get up on a nacelle with this. This looks like it's going to work well. Again, that's the safety Uniflex ruler. That seems to work well. If it's a new plane or a repair, what's a good idea is to just take a little bit of ordinary talcum powder. I mean, just a little bit on a paper towel. Especially on a repair where you've touched this with your dirty hands many, many times. And since I'm going to do all the big straight lines next, just kind of buff it in, wax the talcum powder in. If any stays there, really doesn't matter. The clear just makes it disappear. But it gives you a nice head start on getting the ink to stick without having those lines where you go through a line and there's a skip. That really is a big help, the talcum powder. And what I do, once I get the big straight lines on, then I'm going to have to make a couple of smaller, well, I don't have to make them, they're probably in a drawer there, some smaller templates to get these little lines and angles and corners. Now, one of the things most people that I've seen have an issue with, let's see which side of the ruler, wrong way Corrigan here, is when you're by yourself holding the ruler. Well, we're no different than anybody else. It's just easier, I think, to, let me get some tape, take a couple pieces of tape. Now, what I usually do is I just tape this in place, and then I'll go measure up at the other side. You only need a couple of pieces of tape to hold it in place. Then I can measure my areas to make sure I have the right thickness here, and it looks like I'm close, but again, there's no substitute for having a lot of rulers. A steel ruler. This is a drafting ruler with tape on one side. Nice and flexible again, but it gives you, these will go up to about an 18-inch line. This line is a 22 inches, so I can't do it in one shot. But I can measure just short of two. Okay, we've got this fine final line. Oops, I just let it go. Of course, it's easy if you have somebody else. But one of my, I got to check that this didn't move. One of my objectives is always to be able to do all the work myself, if possible. It's more fun and it's easier if you have a helper. Today it just isn't going to happen. And getting a big line like this on, one by one, the tape really is the way to get it. I'm going right through the line in the star, so I know I've got this real accurate. Any spot that does skip, I can just go back over it with the pen. I see there is a spot that skipped. And just peel the ruler backwards. And we've got one of the big major lines on. And of course, we'll do the same thing for all the lines that go in this direction. I like to just step back once in a while and make sure I'm not losing the symmetry. Without the shading, it's hard to tell. And it'll be real important. I'm working out the flap and back this way. It's always good with ink work to work in one direction, I think, because then you're not putting your own hand back in the wet ink all the time. Once I get this wing panel done, then I'll lay out some of the nacelle lines, copy them right from that side. Another thing I've got to really spend time on is get that shading right. And when I made the shading paint, I made enough, had it left over, I guess I was thinking Tigercat. But to have enough paint that I can go back and get a pretty good match, it's about a 3 or 4 color mix of brown, then dark brown, light brown, and then black. That'll take a little bit of time. And then get all the shading on this. And if we get this all done today, it's looking like this is going pretty smoothly, which is, if anything, unusual. I'm running a simulated spar out. This was really a lot more work than I thought it would be to get that, because everything has to be a mirror image here, or it's not going to look right I'm not going to be happy with it anyway. But so far the ink is laying down very well for a repaired area. Sometimes on a repaired area you just can't get it to lay down to save your life. This looks like it's going to work fine. And you notice the two different colors of silver, once we put the clear on here, we hope it's going to blend a little more. Silver is probably the hardest color of all. The most difficult color to touch up is probably silver. So if we can get that match real nice and get it to look the way we want it to, I'm going to be real happy about it. This is the styrene, and we found one piece, styrene that Ed Cotton brought us. We were able to get make a little template for this incline that's going to go here. It's a curved incline, of course. And we found the one that goes on this side, so saved ourselves just a little bit of time on doing this. Styrene, you just score it with the blade as per, we did that video with Ed Cotton. Score it, clean up the edge with some 600 sandpaper, put the tape on, and you have an incline template for any shape incline you need. And on the bomber, there's quite a few special inclines. Having the sheet styrene just made these go so quick. That's an Ed Cotton model making trick that I've used over and over again. This really works well. And once these styrene templates are taped down, even a curved line like this becomes a one-man job, and that's what's important to me, is to always be able to do these things on my own. Since an awful lot of the time I work in the shop, I work late at night, early in the morning, or around running my business, where it's not reasonable to ask people to just come popping over. And we're ready to flip it over and do the top. Well, as much work as this was, I think the fact that we haven't given up any flying days, we've just given up rainy days. In the fact that I think it's going to be a reasonably good repair. Again, we're ready to flip this over. I am ready to flip it over and start the top. And then we'll have to get the black inside the cowls here, inside the cowl itself.
Hi.
Well, this went pretty well. The only thing left here today, hopefully we'll get the cowling done. We've got to match up the Zeus fittings and the markings to the cowl. And that really constitutes one really good day. Very productive day. And before we put any clear on it, we really would like to see the rain come to an end. We got a couple of other things. Get the black painted on here. Maybe if we had done a little earlier than I anticipated, I can get it all back masked, so if it's sunny tomorrow, we can put clear on. Getting itchy. Coming down a home stretch here. Shading is going to be, before I back mask the plane, I want to very carefully look at each piece of shading and try to replicate it so one side isn't darker or lighter than the other side. And I have some reference here to work with as I get up into the cowls. But what I always try to do is start on the bottom first. The first, this way, if you're gonna get a little sloppy or whatever, it'll be on the bottom. Speaking of that sloppy, hey, you haven't been much help today. Not much help, Baltimore. One of the real smart things we did, of course, is having a cowl mold for these bombers. Can you imagine just carving this out of balsa wood now? Having that mold, and I got the tubing under, I can't get it on, but basically what I have to do is just marry this up and match it. And I think that's going to wind up finishing up a pretty productive day if I get the cowl done, but sure ain't going to paint any clear today. This day has been raining from beginning to end. Not today, all of our shading, when we have a line, we try to do 90% of it exactly the same. Is the dark side would always face away from the fuselage, and the dark side would always go backward. In other words, any of the staining or weathering would be, the airflow would push it back, and in our case, we're anticipating that it would go outward. Again, I try to pick up every line, but if I'm trying to cover up a problem, I can skip that. Like in this corner, I wanted to put a corner. So if I always anticipate these lines all go down to the body, out to the wingtip, and back. So it makes laying this out, and the best way I've found to do this is with a roll of the thick blue tape, 1 inch, I think that's 2 inch tape. I used to do this by laying sandpaper out here and just airbrushing, it would leave a fuzzy line. The blue tape, if you start in one area and just work your way back, or start in the middle, work your way out, so that you're not working over the wet paint. That really seems to be a good way to do it. Just as a starting point, 2 inch tape is usually enough to cover overspray. Tear off a piece of tape. The blue tape that we buy at Home Depot is about the least sticky. Rub it up on an old shirt. And in this case, what I'm going to do is start and get all of the outer lines. Try to get a nice even edge here. Don't have to press it down real hard. I also know that I need to get this corner if I'm going to make it match the other wing. Try to cover up about half of the ink line if you can. And now by starting in the corner, and I'm just checking it, that's what I have. Another trick, don't fill the bottle up with paint. You only need about a spoonful of paint to do the whole plane. Otherwise it's dripping down all the time, and I have to be aware of that all the time. Now I always get the brush started on the tape, and then walk my way out into where I want the shading to be. That gives me a corner. Get some of it on the tape and just let it overspray out into the area you're trying to cover. Once now, I use this tape 8-10 times, but once that tape edge gets wet, then you can't use it. If you do a dry spray, okay, so that gives us the first of the areas. Now I can just work my way out. Let's look at the wingtip. We don't have any on the wingtip. So we can work this area now up by the star using the same piece of tape. In this case, we've just got just a hint in that corner. Sometimes the most effective is when you have the least amount. If in doubt, it's like Letra sets or anything else. A little bit, not enough, is better than too much. You can always go back and add a little more. And if you ever have to take the shading off, Gorham's, take it right off. And then just basically start all over again. We get up to the stains on the exhaust. One of the other things I have is the little hatches have a little stain. I just cut a piece of tape the size of the hatch. And notice I just try to replicate a corner for a corner, an edge for an edge, and go back and forth, always looking at it from several different angles to make sure it's balanced, that I haven't made this side dark or that side unequal. And it's easier if I make it too light. I can always go back and just add. This goes relatively quickly. In fact, today I can finish this whole thing up probably in one sitting. But if you put too much on, really gets to be difficult to lighten it up. It gets to be a lot more work to take it off than to put it on. This is the most labor-intensive part of this whole thing, is getting the exhaust stains to match. I haven't put the brown on yet, the rust color. There's several colors of rust that have to go in there, and it has to be, I hope it's going to match as well as I think it is. Anyway, we got most of the shading done here on the bottom. It's going to be ready to flip it over soon. And I got all the dark on the shading and the exhaust stains. Next step's going to be just to finish up the upper panels here and try to get them to match the part that's finished. Then the last thing will be those brown exhaust stains. I've been kind of putting that off to the end just because that really did get to be labor intensive. I remember that, putting on the old. If you look at the original video, and by the way, if there was anybody that really wanted to see the whole ink job on this plane, it runs on one of our A26 video subscriber videos. All of the detailing and riveting and making templates and everything is on that original tape. Now luckily I have some of this rust colored paint. What I'm going to try to do is just match this. Notice what I'm trying to do is get dark and then just let it fade away. And I'm looking to see if I've got a good balance, because I have some that's a little bit darker, some that's a little bit lighter, and some has a little orange in it. We aren't going to spray any clear today, is it? Man, did we hit this weather bad. Ooh. The exhaust stains end about an inch past there. Now I'm going to have to flip this over and do the bottom, of course, but I think we got it pretty close. Again, just so I got to look at it from a lot of different angles. Before I make it too dark or light or try to improvise too much, the next thing I'm going to do here is backmask the ship and maybe just get a coat of clear up on the nose, even if I have to spray it in the shop here, so that I can see what that shading is going to look like. Now I can always alter it, I can always change it, but it looks like we're close, and I don't want to make it totally darker or totally lighter than the other side if I can. So I've been trying to look at it from a couple of different angles. That was one of the things about the plane that I really liked, was the way that gave the illusion of an exhaust stain. We're just going to have to see what the weather's like tomorrow. We are not lucking out with the weather today. And I don't want to spray clear in this kind of high humidity condition. It's just too risky. Imagine having this all have to be all sanded out and redone after I just did it. We'll just wait. And that's what I always suggest. If you go more than 10 or 20% retarder and it still fogs up, or if it's raining, just wait. Sometimes you just can't push it any harder than you'd like. Yeah, what they predicted today was no chance of rain, nice and sunny, and I'd be ready to shoot my clear. Well, you know what? Not going to shoot anything today, because I know what happens when you get frustrated, and I am getting frustrated. We've just had like 7 or 9 or 10 days in a row of this crap. With little breaks here and there where it isn't raining, and even then, the humidity's way too high, so I think Mr. Cardinal's just going to relax a little bit. The only nice day we had was my birthday. Unbelievable. Well, we'll live to fight another day, and that's what I always suggest when you're going to shoot clear. What I can do with all this lousy weather, I can at least get this all back mask, so if we get a day tomorrow or the next day, I'll at least have the back masking done and it'll be ready to shoot the clear. We're just not lucking out on this. Sometimes you win, and today just doesn't happen to be one of those days. But we'll just put it aside and wait. Well, back masking it with tinfoil, I guess it's the only thing I can get done here. But this rain is unbelievable. What an exciting day today is. I open up my mail. I got all kinds of things relating to the Tigercat here. This one is from Bob Zambelli, and the gentleman that sent it to him was Charles E. Saxon, with a nice article about the role of the Tigercat. Some nice photos. These are actually real photos. I'm assuming they're from Charles Saxon. Now what I know, because I know a little bit from doing my own research, I know this is the versions that had the green stripe. Apparently, these are his own photos, is what it looks like. Maybe he was on, I'll have to read this. He was on, in Korea, which would make these pretty priceless. Anyway, what's neat about doing a project like the Tigercat or the A26 as opposed to a straight wing stunner? Well, what happens is you make these relationships with people who share the common interest. And in this case, we have even more stuff here. Let me get right into this. This came today from Charlie Reeves, and it took me about an hour to read this. He really did his homework. Well, he's building a scale model. He got this from the Department of the Navy. Check this out. Now, they've never done this for me. Painting proposal for Charlie Reeves. And with the color documentation, now this would be, if you were a scale model, it would be priceless stuff. The design, the size of the stars. And this is all Tigercat related stuff. The letters, the numerals, the ID markings, the Navy. the lettering template, which now that I have this, and John Popier has been helping me learn some various programs with the computer, the Photoshop program, I can be able to enlarge this or do other things. Technical markings. Boy, we have really lucked out. Now, Charlie is building a Tigercat, an RC version, and he apparently made me copies of this. I emailed him and he said he made copies of all this stuff. I mean, this is a significant thing to have when you're doing a semi-scale model like this. This is not just chunk change. Now, he also sent, and let me just show this. It's hard to believe, but several of the variations of the Tigercat really, really are exceptional. Now, I think this is one of them. The all blue one, the navy blue one. Notice this one doesn't have the red bar on the stars. This one does have the red bar. Nose cannons, no nose cannons. Red lettering on a tail. I love how the exhausts go over the top of the wing. Now, we just did this on the A26, the exhaust staining. The back of the nacelles is another critical feature. The cockpit area. This back of this fuselage is very narrow. To me, this is a very, very attractive plane for anybody modeling it, for whatever reason. Now, Charlie has really sent a packet, I guess is the right word. There's one of the other variants of the Tigercat. These are like 8.5 by 11 photos, so they'll really be useful. You see where the exhaust under the wing? It's a non-military paint job, of course. Another picture of it. But what's happening is, in the very beginning of any project, this is the twin cockpit version. And I hope Charlie's going to share with us some of the pictures of his RC model, especially if he gets to fly it. Having these friendships and relationships. Now this, I believe, is the one, if I'm reading Charlie's note right, this is the one he's modeling. And this, of course, has the yellow, red. I've seen this modeled before. Blue body. Notice the cockpit has a Bearcat canopy behind the pilot so that the navigator can look out. That would look good as a stunt ship paint job. That'd be an exceptional one. But that's what's fun about doing these projects. This is what makes doing this just a little more fun than, you know, slapping a red leading edge on a plane that you've already built 17 of. And people do choose to do that, but it doesn't really excite me at all. The front view of the Tigercat. This is what we're going to need now, and I'm going to ask Les if he can take this shape and get it blown up to the size that we've made the other two bombers. We also, John Pothier has sent a program so I can calculate wet wing area, the area that's not under the nacelles or the wingtips, and I'll be working with that on a future video, probably very soon, because what's happening is I'm going to want a kit. I'm going to make as many parts for this as I can before we actually start. But I can start with things like making the bell crank. Now this is another variant. F7-2N. Again, these people that do scale modeling, they really do their homework. And these are really, especially when it comes time to doing ink work, as if I didn't need any more inkline templates. We'll be making up 1,000 in templates. But thanks to Ed Cotton, we know how to do it really quickly. Scale drawings showing every rib station, various locations of things, motor mounts. I have to tell you, Charlie, I'm blown away by this. I'm going to send Charlie a copy of this video. Just, I don't know how to thank him. This is unbelievable stuff. Here's the fuselage side view, showing all the ribbing. This is an F1 Tigercat. But as we sit and dream and plan and maybe even kit up some parts and try to get a day that we can paint that clear, more documentation, we are really starting to accumulate a lot of nice stuff now. And this is what really, really drives me onward, is I just enjoy this part of it. I just have built so many traditional stunners, and it's fun to build them. Here's some more little detail things. But when you get involved in a semi-scale project, especially a twin engine, or especially something that's unique, it just takes it to the next level. Now here's the thing showing the Bearcat canopy behind the Pilot. This was the original way they had it, and the Pilot couldn't look out the side, or the, let's call them, they had a navigator. I haven't read the whole thing yet. This is going to be a couple hours of reading. Some of the details, and these will be handy. How handy do you think these will be when it comes time to do all that little detailing and all the little stuff that we enjoy doing? Some of the ones have the cannons right up in the nose. I like that look. That I really like. Here's the documentation for the paint job with the red stripes, the blue, the yellow wings. I guess this is the one. Just can't imagine how much fun having this stuff is. Now here's some more stuff. This picture shows the drone control color with low rear canopy and DF loop cover behind rear cockpit. It's an F7 F2D version that Charlie's building, 75 inch span RC. I'm reading his note. Anyway, as if that wasn't enough, there's more articles. This is the test version with the carrier hook. Again, I have to thank Charlie, and I hope Charlie and I are going to really enjoy a lot of interaction on this upcoming Tigercat project, because this is what makes what we do worthwhile. The hundreds of hours you spend, the energy, there's the cockpit detailing. And how nice is it having all this stuff? Look at this, is restricted stuff. You figure the terrorists are going to be running out and building Tiger Cats with their... look at this, all the different parts of the cockpit. This is the part that I really like. Now he sent some color pictures of some of the variations. The all blue with yellow lettering, Marines, Marine Corps emblem. Now here's an interesting thing. The Korean night fighters, when they were not fueled up, sometimes sat with the nose off the ground until they were fueled. Here's the one I was talking about before with the green striping. A yellow one, now that would be cool. It's a drone, an F7 F3 drone. Well, that might look good as a stunt ship. Trouble is all these things look good. It's a carrier-based Tigercat based aboard the Franklin Delano Roosevelt in October of 45. The original test version, it had spinners. Looks like it's in basically silver or white, hard to tell, or it's just basically unpainted. Again, the blue is very attractive. Can do some shading on the rudder, simulate the ribs. Some of the other various Navy versions, and of course the one Charlie seems to be real excited about building. And I'm not so sure this wouldn't make a great stunt ship. I wouldn't have that canopy on there, though. That would just, I think that would just be a little bit too scale for me and all the rockets. But that paint job, the yellow, red, and blue, the problem is we have so many choices here. And as you look them over and read about it, it just gets more and more exciting. Gives you things to think about, things to dream about. And that's why a project like this just seems to take over your life if you let it. And I always let it, that's the problem. And we're still waiting, even today. The weather stinks. Something we got today from our friend Kevin King. Kevin King is grinding away the yardage up there. making a Spitfire, and he's got the canopy that I sent him and some of the other parts, but one of the things he didn't have was the instruments. And so he went out and bought a set. Now, I didn't have any of these. I looked for them. And he made some copies, I guess, at Staples or something like that. Anyway, he sent me these, which we'll put these in our box of cockpit details. Speaking of cool people, Walt Russell was one of our original subscribers years ago. He dropped out of the event for a while. He's back now with a vengeance. Built several planes. And this is one. Now, this is from a Brodak kit. And he modified it with two bell cranks so that he could have split flaps, increase the wing area. It has two 15s. And the last note that I got from him, he said it does the whole stunt pattern. Now, the only thing I can think of is I would have probably made the tail a little bit longer. I don't know if it's nose heavy or tail heavy, but it looks real nice. It's from Brodak, a modified Brodak kit. I'm going to send some of these into Stunt News. This is a nice looking plane. And we do appreciate all of it. We appreciate everybody sharing things with us. This is the magic of the internet, the magic of video. We're in a world where you can share things. Some of Walt's pictures. That was funny. I got to tell you a funny story. Walt won't mind it either. First day he went to the field to fly the plane, he went to start this engine, no problem. He went to start this engine and the battery hit the fuselage. He couldn't start that engine. So he basically missed a day of flying. Walt, believe me, I've done probably similar things. Anyway, it's got two little LA-15s in it. And of course, because we're very excited about all things Tigercat, here it is in real wood. And by the way, the Brodak kit makes a very nice little plane. The only thing I think, if you're really going to anticipate building one, I'd want to put flaps on it and maybe extend the wings some, which is what he did. And the fact that it does the whole stunt pattern with two 15s makes it a very convenient, easy plane to fly. Can't really see how his two bell crank system works here, but he has two bell cranks in the plane. One's a slave bell crank. Now, Walt used to work, he's a school teacher, he used to work for a Boeing. So, I know he has a good basic knowledge of this stuff because he's built a rare bear and built one of the nicest Cardinals that's ever been built. But of course, I'm a little prejudiced. And maybe if Walt was a cool guy, he'd send us some pictures of that original Cardinal, the 60 size Cardinal. There's a picture of Walt. He went to one of the fly-in demos. They had a demo show out by him and put in the whole stunt pattern. Everybody liked the plane. And I think he's going to be real happy with it. Have that in your Air Force for a long time. Now, Walt, here's the deal. Send us some good weather so we can spray this clear. I'm getting antsy. Now you can see today, it's bright and sunny, blue skies, but look at the table. It tells you what kind of humidity you have here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to check the weather report, see if it's going to get better today. And I did a little paint test on a tip weight box just to see if it would fog up, and it fogged up. Now even though it's bright and sunny, there's our test of what the humidity is. What I'm going to do is put the weather channel on, get an idea if this is going to stay. But we are really in a bad situation with this weather, because when it's not raining, the humidity is 99%. But anyway, what this is telling me is it's probably unlikely that I'm going to be able to paint. But what I do is another test. In other words, here's what you can do is, let's see what time it is now. It's 8 o'clock, 8:30. Well, we try the tip weight box at 10, and maybe at 12. The best time of the day to paint is between 12 and 2 o'clock. The humidity is the lowest there. But in some cases, like today maybe, it's just going to be humid all day, so we'll just have to wait. But that's all part of this. our goal was to get the clear on this so the clear could be dry, and while we're at Midgley's contest, we're going to be away for 5 days. What I did here, if you look at, here's the local weather. We have a weather channel that's on 24 hours a day. What we're interested in is the Newark weather, 66 degrees. Well, yeah, we know it's, but it's the humidity. So if you're in doubt, you know, one of the things you can look for roughly is, yeah, here's the oh, Greece. Who cares about the Olympics? These fake Olympics. Who even cares? Get the local weather. Now here's what you can do if you get to a point like this where this is just fogged over, and you know you're not going to be able to paint. Well, what I always do is I always have a little mix. I keep a little can with a mix of about half retarder and half Brodak clear. And what I'll do with this, just to get rid of this fogginess, is just put a mix of that as the compressor kicks on. Put a mix of that right on top of this, and that'll get rid of the fogginess so I'm not burying moisture in the paint. Okay, here's what we care about. The humidity is 87 right now. Look at this, 87. But now what I can do is, and I know at 87% you're dead in the water. There's no point even trying to paint. Anything above 70 is really dangerous, is really a problem. So what I'm going to do is leave the weather channel on temporarily. And when I see, they give the, our local weather anyway, they give it twice an hour. When that gets down to about 70, I'll do another test. And hopefully, well, we're going to find out if this day is a write-off or if we're going to be able to spray clear. But you just can't rush this part of it. While I'm waiting for that humidity to come down, I made up some Tigercat parts, and I'm going to start doing this. These are the horn uprights. I'm going to start making parts whenever I'm waiting for clear to dry. Fill this table up with what will amount to be kit parts for the Tigercat. And I've done this in the past so that when we actually get to the day we're going to build a tail or a wing or the body or whatever, I have what amounts to be a kit or parts of a kit ready to go. But right now it looks like we're going to be making a lot more kits than anything else, because that weather just does not look promising. It looks like there's the 5 day. Look at this, rain and thunder showers for the next 1, 2, 3, 4, the next 4 days. Rain and thunder showers. So we may just be, we may be done building a Tigercat by the time we get the spray to clear here. Unbelievable. We're waiting for our humidity to come down. Hopefully it will. What I did, I had these plans from Dave Downey that were all in pieces, like a checkerboard. I laid out the B-25, the original Dave Downey drawing, took some dimensions off it, and then pieced together what amounts to be the beginning of our Tigercat drawing. Now, in this case, it's a little bit bigger than I want it to be, so I'm going to have this drawing scale down again. Going to see if Les can get that done. But we had a rough, it was nice laying it out in full size and just getting a look at, it's a beautiful airplane. It's got a lot of nice curved areas. And one of the things about making a carbon fiber body that's real attractive is the more curves you can put into it. In other words, a carbon fiber flat box is not a real efficient use of carbon fiber. Where you get the strength is from the curves. And it looks like there's almost no part of this fuselage that won't be curved. So the next step of this will be to get a shrunk down version. And I'm thinking Dave Downey is recommending 92%. We'll probably start with a 92% version of this at some future time. But this is what's nice about having, say, the original B-25 drawings, and we can compare shapes, sizes, volumes. It's nice to just lay one on top of the other. And if I get a chance later today, if we're going to have a high humidity day all day, what I'll do, I'll run down to copy shop, try to get this made up myself, and then get a Mylar made the right scale at 92%, just so we have a rough idea of how this is going to lay out. Another interesting comparison, because I have a Mylar of this already, is to lay the A26 right on top of the Tigercat and get some relative positioning of where the wing is going to be, the tail. This is really nice having these things on Mylar. You can do like a Disney cartoon. But the next, our next step is to make up a Mylar once we get this shrunk down. Because as I've said, you can see in the back, I don't want to have it. This is already as big as I would want it, and I've got to shrink it down this amount. I don't want the rudder that big either. The A26 rudder is probably the biggest rudder in the world of control line. Al Raven and I have had that argument already, but I don't know. I think that's one of the sexiest parts of the plane. But anyway, let's see if we can get this down 92% and then compare it one right with one right on top of the other, the three bombers. Now we're just under 70% humidity, and it looks like it's going to dry up fine. This has been sitting out here for just about a half an hour. What I always do is spray the test, make sure the test doesn't fog up. That tells me that the mix I have has, and in this case we got about 10% retarder in the mix. I would even feel safe adding a little more, maybe up to 20, before I got panicky about it, but that looks like it's going to be drying up just nice. So I'm going to get the fuselage out, the wing, and let's see if we can get a couple coats of clear on that before it starts raining again.
Just going to see if the humidity gods are on our side today. You never can tell when they're smiling on you. Now, since all this clear is going on the outer wing, it's nowhere as near as critical as if it was going on the inner wing, so I can pretty much not be too concerned with that, although I don't want to... I was hoping this repair would add less than 5 ounces, at which point I think we're very, very safe and it won't even be a problem. With an 800-inch wing, a 75-ounce plane is still going to be, I think, as competitive as I would like it to be. Anyway, while these coats are drying, we're going to work on that Tigercat drawing. Or drawings. Now, notice that I'm doing the bottom first, because if it fogs up, I'd rather have it fog up on the bottom than on the top. To give this a half an hour, flip it over, roughly 30 minutes. Then when you're dealing with humidity, it's better to give it a lot of thin coats, let each coat dry out, especially with this sun, it'd probably be drying in less than a half an hour. And once that dries, we'll flip it and do the top. I'm just looking as the light reflects off it for any spot that might be dry or that I might have missed. Actually, it doesn't look too bad. So we just let this set up, do the top, and we are waiting for the next raindrop. Putting extra right over where the repair ends. Try to keep that edge as neat as possible.
looks like we really have lucked out. Everything is drying up beautifully. It's a good feeling to have this clear on here. Just gonna let it dry up. Hope for the best. And basically tomorrow we'll decide if we need more clear or if this is gonna be enough. And again, I'm not looking for a concourse finish, even on a concourse winner. We just wanna make a functional plane out of this and get testing our counter-rotating props as soon as possible. Today all that's left is seeing how the clear dried up. That looks okay. But keep in mind, this is not gonna be like the ultimate buff out finish, but I think it looks good enough. Certainly is gonna be acceptable for this type of repair. The things we still have to do: take off the tin foil, put the tank and engine in and the cowl, clean up these fillet lines, and run a piece of sandpaper in there. I can see there's a little bit of paint got in there. What I did by the fuselage is put a piece of Teflon in between so this didn't get clogged up. And then try to get out to the flying field, and sooner or later, I guess, if we get a decent day, we're gonna be ready for a test. It may even be ready today. It's not raining today. We'll see once we put it all together. Well, the only disappointing part of the whole repair was it added 8 ounces. But all of the 8 ounces are in the outer panel, and it really didn't disturb the CG all that much. In fact, I'm going to fly it without putting any trim, nose, or tail weight in until I see. One of the things I probably can offset, I probably can take some tip weight out and maybe get it down to 7.5. But even at, it's at 78 ounces now, at 78 ounces, it's roughly the same weight as the B-25, so we have two, and the B-25 certainly flies within the limits that I think are good and enjoyable and whatever. But anyway, it's the definition of a great adventure. Not knowing where you're going, not knowing how it's going to turn out. This has really put a strain on my mentality, but it is such a good feeling to have this back in one piece. And we might be able to get a 1/2 ounce of clear off if we wet sand it out, but of course we need to wait for that. And what's coming up, actually tomorrow, is Midgley's contest. So we won't be able to buff it out or anything till after that, but maybe we'll get a test flight on it this afternoon if it looks promising. But the day this crashed, I never thought I'd see it in one piece again. And maybe it's better that we're gonna test these counter-rotating props with, which are coming up, of course, with a plane that's a little on the heavy side, push it to the limit. It's just, this plane right from the get-go has been a great adventure. It's added a lot to my life, and to be honest, I've enjoyed every minute of it. And the feeling I have here is he's finally home. After being away for a long time, he's finally home. Oh, it's funny, not funny. The last time I rolled in these lines, our A26 was in a bunch of pieces. And I went back over to the spot where we actually did have the accident. Believe it or not, there's still a few feathers over there. I thought I got rid of all of them. Anyway, we're going to get a test flight. We're not going to be able to get it on video because nobody's here. We're all by ourselves. But hopefully we'll be able to learn something about the trim of the plane. And with all that weight in it out in a cell, I assume the first thing I can do is, after a flight or two, and I'll leave it the way it was for the first flight, start pulling some tip weight out. And then look forward to the day we can buff out a lot of that clear off the outer panel. I think that'll really be something that'll have some positive impact. Maybe we can get it down. The best I'm assuming that we'll ever get it down is to 76. But with the two lighter motors, if we go to using those in the future, that'll bring it down to 74. Well, but it's not going to be long, and the 40s are going to be legal. And I think that's going to change the whole character of the whole plane. But boy, it's good to be back. Good to be home. Good to be at the flying field. After every flight, we've been taking tip weight out. Like you can see, this has already been painted red. We're down to this, and it looks like we're going to be able to take almost all of the tip weight out. So it looks like the next time we get to fly, we'll be down to 77. That really is... Imagine if you put all this weight in the other wing, right now you'd just be dead in the water. So I think it's just going to require a total retrim. And when we have that, we're really going to be... I hope. It seems like it doesn't fly a whole lot different.
Well, we decided to take the bomber up to Midgley's contest. And it's really a fun fly, not a contest, but there are reported going to be a few other twin-engine planes there. And that'll be on the next tape, so we'll see you then. Thanks for joining us. Share the tapes with everybody. And don't hit any birds.
Now, can you imagine if we had never repaired this? You just think all these videos that I watch all winter building the Tigercat would have been a lot less meaningful. Right now they have a lot of meaning because we still have the plane. But look at this, and you can see how out of trim that wing was at the Nats. Oh man, can't believe I had a wing that was that out of trim. Anyway, that's all part of the retrim process, and we're going to try to push this even further. And we certainly will have, I hope, a long, enjoyable future flying this plane. One thing that didn't change, the corner is still great on this plane. It really does have a nice corner. Thank you.